to visit Peru and to go to Cusco and the little restaurants of the street that serve roast guinea pig. So, in order that we're not here until 11:30 tonight, we could all talk for about an hour to each of these people. But what we'll do is we'll just start with Kimball and take about 5 minutes to talk to Clarinetis and anyone else make any pertinent comments you might have. We'll try to keep it brief. Okay. So, where did you make my well?
Mendoza. I was happy with that. In general, like, I felt more in control.
Than usual?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What were you not so happy with?
I had a hard time with, like, feeling the tools in my head.
Which one? Generally or just that?
Yeah. I was, like, kind of everywhere.
Yeah. You know when we get nervous,
yeah,
things get tight and we start to our sense of time,
yeah,
so can move it out the window. Yeah, so it's really important to like be able to find ways to counteract that tension, and just so you can, because even tension in the body will change our sense of pulse.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I thought it was quite fluid. What I would like to hear more of is like, be very convincing about how you get to the top of the phrase and then going away, so that it's like a real progression of the sense that you're taking the audience along your ride and pointing out the architecture of the piece, be a little bit more like sentences, paragraphs, you know, phrases, and a little bit longer idea of the overall structure. Be careful of your phrase endings. Oftentimes I find that it's not a nice taper at the end, it kind of goes, done. And sometimes it ends up being louder than what's happened before. So just be careful with things like that. And at the end of, technically, at the end of the Mozart, the exposition, you know, you have the, starting more
even. Okay.
You just be nailed for that in an audition.
Yeah.
Okay. The Beethoven. The danger in this excerpt is that it's always going to sound great. And also the way it's orchestrated, you have pretty much just the two horns and the cellos down below the triplets. So the tendency in solos is to really sound bright. So you have to use, to get very clarinet technical at the moment. You know, a lot of upper lip coming in the size that we talked about. Because when you got to the B's, it was kind of bright. Remember we talked about the other day?
Yeah.
Just be careful of that. You know at the end of those crescendos, blah, 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 and the subito pianos?
Yeah.
When you get to the top, you make that be as loud as you get. Don't get any louder than that.
Okay.
It doesn't sound natural to go da 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 da. When you get to that point, that's as loud as you need. In Summer Night's Dream, I thought your tongue would be quite fluid. But make sure that you count all the rests in between carefully.
Okay.
Because the committee is going to be the same. You know, even when you have like one bar or two bars rest, you just count those rests exactly. And towards the end, when you go down, you have the hell notes in your lower register, blah, 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 before the fast little passage. The pitch reduction quite wonky.
Okay.
So be careful of that, because one of the things we're listening for mostly is rhythm and pitch. So really be careful down there. Sibelius, your rhythm. Like even right from the third and the fourth bar, the pulse didn't sort of stay. You need to like think of the big subdivisions and twos, but also underlying have, you know, the 4-4 going on also. Okay. And just at the end, in terms of how you taper that whole end down to the triple pianissimo, could be a little bit more better planned.
Okay.
You know, when you have these within the penis, you know that the crescendo, diminuendo, that sort of got all of a sudden it's just like a like too much. Okay? So just be careful in places like that. I think I mentioned to you about Stravinsky when we had it for the second climate audition for the job here.
Yeah.
That rhythm eliminated, you know, 85% of the candidates. It's a really good one for like figuring out what the rhythm needs to be. You know, and technically, you didn't have a great outing. And especially like when you get up high, the pitch just kind of goes, and the sound is a little bit out of control.
Yeah.
Right, so you need, again, like a lot of control here. The armature putting in here at the upper lips. Yeah, it would get like, it was just a wee, like in those lines at the end. Oh, yeah, there you go. Okay. Rimsky Korsakov, like we just talked about earlier, this is better, but you know, the evenness of the. Make sure that it's never. You don't want that. You want it to sound like grace notes. B flat solo. Again, we talked about it being before about being, I call it sort of in the game, like from the very first bar. It takes you like a, after the first bar, they were great. The first bar was like that.
Yeah.
Didn't know. Yeah. Did you hear Michelle's audition?
Mm-hmm.
Like, everything was really well planned out. For her. I mean, she was always in the game from the very, very beginning of every excerpt. You need to be a little bit more that way. Like with rhythm and also the setup here. So that it's right from the very first note. Okay. Otherwise, I thought it was pretty good. But I'm giving you things that, you know, you need to.
I'm really listening to that as the other one of the other soloists in that, and while you're playing, I'm really hearing my part and whether I can fit in with what you're doing. So you have to remember people on the panel, other instruments will be hearing their part meshing with yours.
Yeah, that's it. But what you want is the committee to really hear their own part being your play, like,
mm-hmm.
or to hear the orchestra. Imagine how what you're doing fits in the orchestra. And it's amazing when you're sitting on an audition panel when somebody plays a part, like they really know how it fits into the whole, all of a sudden you start to remember the other parts of the orchestra.
Yeah.
I don't know how to describe it other than that. It's like you just, it really makes, everything makes sense. And that's the type of, that's the impression you want to give the committee, that we can rely on you at all times, that you come prepared and you know you know the music, you know how your part fits into the whole.
Okay. I thought the beginning of the Mozart was really nicely set up. I mean, it was a good feeling. It was a good soloistic outing. It's a really hard room to play. The room stinks. You're not having any favors done by playing it here. The sound tended to be a little bit thin at times. I wanted to hear more warmth. And a lot more dynamic contrast in the solo. There were some finger issues here and there along the way. Watch out for. There was some intonation issues. I was noticing the more in the low end. In the I'm not gonna remember what I've written things, but I'd have to look at the music. I can read my own writing. Find a way to warm up the sound a little bit. You have to beat the room.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't always managed to do that, just in terms of sound, in the projection, in the quality of sound that's getting across to us.
I really liked your audition. That was a really solid audition. I noticed different things from some of the other people. So, without going through everything, one thing that I would echo in both the Mozart and the Beethoven is thinking about phrase endings. It's something for everybody as one players. At the end of the phrase, often we're thinking about what we're going to be doing next, and we neglect to take care of that last note or the last two notes and the way we finish. So, it's just a detail. I noticed some intonation things. In each of the excerpts, I had different comments than what can be made, so it just goes to show that we listen for different things if we don't play the instrument. So I'll talk to you sometime about a couple of details, but it was good strong audition.
I'll give you some comments on Saturday. You want to go to food?
Okay. I thought you played a great audition. Stephanie's done a couple of professional auditions, and I feel like there's a real confidence there that gaining experience with that. You sound very refined, beautiful sound, very confident. The one thing I really noticed about your Mozart was that the pulse was absolutely steady. And sometimes there were some things that needed cleaning up with articulation, some of the passage work, so that took away from it a bit. But the thing I really liked was that I was absolutely confident about the pulse. Very, very steady. And just your style and the way you presented it. I liked it a lot. And the Mozart, often in a first round, I mean, maybe it's less common these days, but often in first round, the first thing that you will hear is the exposition of Mozart. So it's very important to have, can be often your first impression. And I really liked what you did and I wanted to hear more, so that I thought was great. But yeah, just a few details with, articulation. So. Beethoven, I thought the opening was really good. It's always hard to tell with that first note because you can't really tell what the flutist, her tempo, because her tempo in their mind is. But possibly it was a little long with what you did afterwards, but it's really hard to tell. But I felt like your intonation was very, very good. It got just a hair flat on the B, like we talked about, but it's almost there. And absolutely controlled and great sound all the way through to the F sharp. Bar 19, or at least bar numbers. I think that's the end of that beginning phrase. So it's a little flat on the last G in F sharp. And again, this is the thing, as a flute player, as a wind player, I know that was because you were running out of air. But string players on a committee might just hear it's flat. So if your wind player is on a committee, it would be more forgiving. And, I know that you're not playing it flat because that's how you hear it. I know you're just running out of air. But someone else might just think you're just playing it flat. Okay? So, so the triplets. You started out great. And then it got a little unsteady. It got a little slower as he went on. So you always have to hear that, the violins. It just keeps going. It has to be like a clock. Okay? So generally pretty good, but it got a little slow. But very, very refined and beautiful. Okay. The Allegro, I thought this was really, really good. Lots of energy. I liked your scale on the way up. I liked what you did with the fortepiano. Good energy, a couple of chip notes in there, but very, very good. The last note, the pianissimo, it should be a little more black and white, just absolute different color all of a sudden. And I felt like it was a little long, actually. Okay, just keep that tempo absolutely steady. Debussy, okay. So I thought what you did was beautiful, and you breathe after the G. That this is actually why I put this on. We talked about this. Why I put this on the list with my, because I wanted to talk to the other players about, does it matter if there's a breath in that opening solo? Does it matter where it is? If the person plays it really beautifully, and I mean, I have my own opinions as a flute player about what I want to hear and what matters and what doesn't matter, but I'd like to hear other opinions. I mean, did you think anything of the breath, or did you not notice it? Was it, did it matter at all?
I noticed that it didn't bother me at all because of the way you shaped the end of the note before the breath. That's that's everything right there. If you round off that note right, then the breath is not okay.
It was a musically appropriate place to breathe. Mm-hmm. Even if it's not a traditional place to breathe. Stuff happens in auditions. And I thought, kudos, because that may or may not have been your ideal place to breathe, but we often have to have emergency breaths for situations where nerves take over a little bit. But that was a musically appropriate place to breathe, so it didn't bother me. Didn't detract.
I couldn't care less. I heard Russell Moyes coach this numerous times, and he scoffed at the idea that you should do it in one breath. He thought it was nonsense, and he knew the composer, so. I really liked the colors you used, the vibrato. It was very, very beautiful. Bronze, your triplets were great starting, and then I felt you were a little late coming in on the high beat. So just that tempo, keep it going. And again, we're all hearing our own parts in the orchestra, and the music keeps going during the rest. So we hear something that's a little late coming in after the rest. You don't have to play all of these things in orchestra to sort of fake it out. You can play all the recordings. That's what I did. I remember in learning for auditions. When you're young, because you haven't played a lot of the repertoire actually in an orchestra, but you can, if you play along with recordings, you can get used to what else is going on and play as if you've done it. And yeah, that can really work. And I really liked what you did with the Brahms. I like the shape of it, the architecture of it. Really, really nice. Remember, again, thinking of what else is going on, remember the horns that they keep playing and making you keep going. Firebird, I thought, was very solid. I thought sometimes the passages were a little, spread out the notes a little more so that we really hear clearly, da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da.
twice, I felt like with the rubato that you did, I just felt like it was a little off from what would have been happening accompanying you. And then, you know, keep your focus right till the end, the last troll is a little messy. But I thought it was a very, very solid round. And I would have wanted to hear you again in the second round.
She really knows what the horn players are thinking.
How do we show the different characters of the different composers and different sounds? It was a beautifully imaginative bronze and really captivated me, but maybe to take it to the next level, imagine what the entire mood of this symphony is. Imagine where this soul happens. And if you can even get more weight into your sound, to contrast with some of the more effervescent kinds of things that you have to play, it might be just something to consider as you refine it, because it's already
at some point, you talk to a good violinist and say, show me the kind of stroke that you use there. Mm-hmm. What's the position? It's going to totally change it. You can conceive of playing that within the context of the violinist. Blah, 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 blah. Be really important. And also, you know, as wonderful as you play the extended Pascalia's solo yourself, you don't show to me that you understand this different orchestration, rhythmic orchestration in almost every other bar. Slightly different structure, and I'm not quite understanding it. It's a fairly.
You can show the couplets out of it.
Mm-hmm.
You can play it very well. You might consider showing, I think, is that part of it?
Well, there's a couple of this spot where it's empty in the second eight, and spots where it's supported, and that wasn't.
Mm-hmm. Actually coming out.
So that just feeds into the whole holistic principle. The most important thing that I feel when I'm talking to my own students about preparing for an audition is you spend as much time listening with the score in front of you as with the part in front of you, because you learn so much more having the score in front of you. But you're an amazing player, generally. It was beautiful playing. So I was just a bit disappointed when a couple of spots where I thought, you know, she needs to think a little deeper about the score at this spot. And that was one of them.
I was captivated right from the beginning that Mozart was very elegant playing. Sometimes when there are quick pairs of slurs, you use just a little bit more emphasis on the first one. It rushes off that first one a little bit too quickly. You know, that there's enough emphasis on and it happens so many times in so many excerpts. There were times in the Beethoven I'd have to find where, but when you have repeated notes, sometimes your pitch changes a little bit with your change in dynamics.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be aware. The music I thought was very beautiful. The second statement, your pitch didn't match what your first statement was. I didn't think it was quite as solid for pitch. The G seemed a little also question a couple of intonation things in your bell, but I couldn't get to tell you where. Too many notes on the page. Or maybe I don't have to deal with this. We have like 3 notes on a page. But really love the thing. Lots of energy, clear in all the registers.
She already got one. So congrats. I can see where you're doing really well on auditions. And a lot of the things that we've been talking about, you've integrated really well. So congrats. That's great. We can talk about a lot of the details. Just a couple of general things. You came out and you played your Mozart with authority, great style. The details, your rhythm is good, your intonation is good. It sets the stage. When your Mozart really is strong, it's just something to think about for everybody, that oftentimes we make a yes or no decision about somebody within the first 10, 15 seconds. It's sort of like when you meet somebody, oftentimes you get a feel for, I either like the person or I really don't like the person, or maybe I want to get to know them a little bit, but and immediately I think what I was thinking was, I really like this person. That person just set themselves up well. So I think that's just a nice, I think you should tell everybody what your secrets are for how you can come out and have everything work out so nicely, because I think it's a hard thing to do, and you made it sound very easy, so that was great. Great style, all that stuff. You made us cry in the Bronx, It's what you're supposed to do in that solo. So that's exactly what we were feeling, we're just thinking of this incredibly heartfelt thing that you were able to do, so it's great. Just a couple of little details. In the Tchaikovsky versus the Brahms, there are 2 slow solos, one after the other. Usually when we're choosing excerpts, we kind of vary it a little bit more. So one thing you might think about when you have to do that is, how do I make the Tchaikovsky sound a little different from the Brahms? What's different about the mood of the piece? What's different about the color? How can I show variety? I'm not just a beautiful expressive player, but I'm also able to show even more color variety. So that might be something to just take it to the next level. You could think of being even more hushed at the opening of the Tchaikovsky to create an even more intimate feel or something like that, So that's a variety thing you can show. We'll talk about a couple of details, but I think you really you brought the things into the audition that we talked about when we were working, and it seemed like you did the things that you wanted to do. Did you feel like you did the things you wanted to do?
Mm-hmm. For the most part.
Yeah.
But I'm glad to hear that, like, the things we were talking about, I was trying to do them, the things that we talked about in our lessons, I was trying to do them tonight, so I...
Oh, yeah. It really came through. Another thing, just for people who are not familiar with what we do, a lot of times what's difficult about an audition is that we don't necessarily get a sense of what it will be like to interact with the person in an ensemble. And the conductor especially wants to have a sense of whether the person is going to be receptive and flexible, able to respond to things like tempo changes or style changes or breathe in a different place or articulation changes. And this is part of life in an orchestra. I mean, you have to be flexible enough that you can do things more than just, this is my way, this is how I prepared it, and it's the only way I can do it. As you're getting more and more successful in your auditions, you're probably going to start being asked to do things because they like you and they want to know, okay, let's see if there's maybe a possibility to say, play Tombo de Couperin a little faster, or Stalli Simor, I'd like you to phrase it differently. So that's the thing that's really nice, because now you and I know each other, but if I had never met you, I would have just said, very beautiful, polished audition, but we want to be able to interact. So be thinking about that as you're preparing also. What might be another thing that I'm asked to do? What might be possibly asked of me? And then if you can do that, we didn't have time for it, but if you can, then that's even better. Then sometimes if it's only the screen all the way to the finals and you're the person that was able to be more flexible, that might be the thing that wins you the
both ask me, say, could you, sometimes they'll just say something like, you're waiting to be that specific. They say, could you play that differently? And I can't tell you how many times that we've been sitting behind the screen and someone's asked someone to do something and we'll come back exactly as they just played it. For. No alteration whatsoever, and then everyone just turns the page. So if you're asked to do something different, it's because the committee is interested in you. So feel, take that as like having the courage to actually do something different. Don't be so trapped in like the way you had learned it, played it, that's the only way. And I guess that's partly your preparation. You think, well, maybe I'll try some various different ways of playing, approaching an answer. You know, so just if you ask for something like that, it's because we like you. We're interested. So.
Speaking of that, Michelle, the only thing that I didn't like about your audition was the high C at the beginning of the concerto. So if you were asked to play that differently, what would you do?
I think I would take away the vibrato at the beginning, and because I felt like I was trying to have a little bit less vibrato at the beginning, and then crescendoing in the last bar, adding a bit more vibrato. But I think if you asked me to do it differently, I could try to make that really obvious. Like I've heard people do it with no vibrato, and I actually think it's a cool effect. It's a cool effect, but it's not the way I played it.
See, after you were finished with the IC, I loved the rest of your audition. But if I had had to judge you just for the opening, I would have been really disappointed at that high C. It's like you never really got it going. It's like I felt a chimeric. Why is the vibrato not spinning?
So you think I didn't open up the vibrato enough at the end?
No, it's not that. It's just that you were sort of timidly walking between two possibilities without committing yourself. And incidentally, the only other thing about that on occasion was also not your high C, but your middle C. And that was, I was just wondering, in track four, at least in this room, your middle C does not resonate like your notes around it.
We talked about that a little bit.
Yeah.
Did you think that? Yeah, it's a bit of a dead note for you, and I was wondering whether it applies or not for the high C too.
It's something for everybody to consider register breaks. You know, going between closed notes and open notes, it's just something we have to integrate into our practicing. And she and I did talk about that.
Yeah, okay. Should we move on for time?
Yeah, it was a really lovely audition. Lots of energy, great sound. For me, the one most disappointing note was that long-held D in the slow part of Rossini. It just sat there.
The low G or the high G?
Do something. Warm it up. Yeah. But yeah, really love the thing.
Where did you get those articulations?
For which?
They're beautifully tasteful.
Yeah.
So really good choices.
You had the biggest challenge with the room, playing into that wall and that door. So we've talked about having a little bit more ease, a little bit more energy in the sound. Bouncing off the wall, it almost felt a little bit muscular at times. So part of it is figuring out the room that you're in. To be able to get that immediacy, that clarity at the beginning of notes without it becoming too strongly articulated. The other interesting thing you have to sort of work your way around is having spent a couple of years in Germany, you've got a pretty good vibrato going in your sound. It's not always there, but it's less common here, and it's something that will certainly set you apart in an audition for good or for bad. Some people might prefer to hear some of it, some people may not. And it certainly is a distinctive element to your sound. So mean, I use very little vibrato personally. I'm not opposed to the sound. I mean, I like the sound, but you have to use it carefully. You have to use it in certain places and be able not to use it in certain places. I mean, depending on the style of the music you actually hear. Yeah. It was, I think, most prevalent in the concerto, which is probably the best spot for it. But again, you're not going to convince everybody on the panel. It's a bit of a guessing game. But you have to be aware of this element of your sound. We talked about this a little bit. The first 16-tone scale in the concerto is still slow. Just having a hard time getting that going. Once you get going, the 16ths come off really nicely, and there's good, you know, sort of rhythmic integrity. But that first one, that's the first thing we're hearing. Spend a little bit more time. There are chip notes that come into play maybe a little more often than I'd like to hear. Interestingly, you were playing off all your own parts. Because we had a different order in the booklet that we had. Not a big deal. And if somebody played something out of order in one of our auditions, we would stop them. Now, in this setting, I didn't think it was important to do that. But as a matter of keeping things fair and consistent and clean and everybody gets the same opportunity to do everything and everybody is going to move from, you know, maybe the high excerpt to the low excerpt to the loud excerpt, whatever. Everybody has to do it the same way. The Ravel was lovely. It was very lyrical. Rhythmically, didn't always work. Coming off the long notes, like, you're not always counting through the long notes. You come off cleanly. You've got a really lovely line going, but it's not always rhythmically accurate. There's a really nice soloistic sound in the Brahms. Again, if you can maintain that espressivo and still keep that dotted rhythm a little bit more accurate, it still sounds just a little bit triply. And you don't want it to sound too notey. You don't want that, but you have to maintain that rhythmic accuracy and still have the lyricism. The opening of the Beethoven is just half notes. I mean, we talked about this a little bit. It doesn't look like much on the page, but you still have to think of it as a solo. More direction, more focus, more connection between the notes, and not just individual half notes, because it's more than just backward. It's this really interesting contrapuntal thing that's going on. So if you can think of it as more of a solo as they run. Once again, the difference between the part you were playing off of it and ours, you played in the Shostakovich, you played the second part at the end, and we had the first part in our audition. But again, if you're going to walk into an audition with your own parts, you have to make sure that what you've got there is matching what the whole committee has. I mean, sometimes there are differences in articulations, and once in a while, you can find differences in notes. So it's something to be aware of. Intonation is tough in that excerpt. Maintaining a consistent and even timbre as we're going back and forth, maybe between F and B flat horns, and as we're going to different registers, it's a nasty thing to be able to do to maintain a consistent sound down that low. But there were certain notes that had more resonance and certain notes that were a little bit. Didn't quite have the same character. good sound. There's some really beautiful phrasing going on. Yeah.
Just be careful, though, that you don't take too much time between excerpts.
Okay.
Like I found, for me, you're almost on the borderline of taking too long between excerpts. And if your candidate is kind of like, or people are sort of like on the fence about whether to advance or not, they start to lose interest if you keep taking a lot of time between excerpts. And for me, from my experience of sitting on the committee, it was on the borderline of being too long to finish them. And a lot of people always ask, how long should you take, you know, to get into it? And I would not take any more time, for example, between excerpts.
I really enjoyed your sound and your musicality. The thing that I found was consistently bothering me was rushing through counted breaths or tight notes. Yeah. And I did ask, this is an example of something that sometimes happens in committees. I asked Larry about the Shostakovich, what makes that difficult, whatever, because, you know, I'm a good player. So that often would you talk about that kind of stuff. Different instruments and try and find out what makes something difficult and what's challenging about it. I'm sure we'll be doing that with two auditions.
When those little counting things happen, were you consciously thinking, I'm a little tired, or is it something that you were aware of after it happened as you were playing at all? Do you know what we're talking about?
Yeah.
A note doesn't quite last long enough.
Yeah, sometimes yes, I think sometimes. Probably more yes, and then it had already passed, and there was nothing I could
do. Does it go with either like nerves or fatigue, you know?
Yeah, probably both.
Because sometimes it's useful for us to figure out what are the things that happen in auditions that don't always happen in our playing. That's something to think about. Your musicality shone through, even though it sounded like maybe you were a little tired. You know, we were talking this afternoon a little bit. You know, that happens. Sometimes we get tired towards the end of the audition. But you still brought your musicality in places like the turn of the Brahms, which I thought was really nice. And also, I felt like you rallied at the end of the Strauss. I thought, I could feel, maybe she's a little tired. And then I felt like you gave some more energy. And that's another thing that I like in an audition. Sometimes an audition will be going along okay, and then somebody has a little bit of trouble with something. And then it's easy to think, well, okay, I think I'm going to pass on this person. And then they play another excerpt, and they kind of really sell themselves. And suddenly, you're back in the game. Suddenly, the committee says, oh, wow, okay, they went for it. And sometimes I'm really persuaded. So just something to keep in mind as you're auditioning. So I appreciate the fact that you brought energy at the end. So, good for you.
Yuping. Starting with Marriage of Figaro Overture, I liked all three of your tempos. Next time, how do you prepare yourself when you're behind a screen before you begin an excerpt? How do you remember a tempo? All of us need a strategy in difficult excerpts. When the adrenaline is pumping, how do we find a tempo? Is that what you listen to?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, make sure you're solid in that tempo, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Bolero, what do you listen for before you begin?
That
is a
drum.
Apropos the question of how long to wait, you can certainly wait long enough to hear the two-bar pattern in the snare drum.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, give yourself time to hear that, then you find the tempo, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Right, spring. Why do the grace notes have to be so fast? You know, the problem with the grace notes, none of the people in the room who don't play the bassoon would not understand that all these keys that we have in the bassoon, there's only a few places where we move our fingers against wood and there's no resistance. And that's one of them. So it's really easy to play like a piccolo. It's so fast it just sounds like you have water in your
a difference in waltz tempos between Tchaikovsky and Johann Strauss. Understand, tempo de valse in Johann Strauss is not the same tempo as a Tchaikovsky waltz. You're a little too quick. You're too much in one. You have a beautiful sound. It's a really good audition. I saw just all these sort of issues of finding tempos in the issue for me.
Yeah, I would agree. There were too many times that the beginning of an excerpt didn't have not just tempo, but didn't have the energy that you found a couple of bars later. And so my first impression was not necessarily positive, but then you sort of won me back. You have to do that right from the first note. You have to make your first entrance have all the energy and all the life that you're going to have three bars later. It certainly happened in your concerto, it certainly happened in Figaro. Figaro just felt labored at the beginning. And it's gonna have sparkle. It's gonna have energy right from the beginning.
Yeah. Anything else?
Beautiful sound at the beginning of your rebel.
Yeah.
It was a beauty. That was a moment where I really became much more interested in this candidate when I heard the beginning of that, because you are imagining the color that is appropriate. It's very nice. How's your double tone?
I did a single tone.
You single tone that?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So, between now and your next audition, be able to double tone, right? Because you might be asked to play it faster. That's a must. Because, I mean, we play this. How many times a year do we play this, Chris? Eight? It's a standard encore piece for our orchestra. It's concerts, you know, whatever we need. So, and sometimes it goes really fast. So, just be prepared.
Are there any questions? Comments?
I've got a question. How did you feel behind the screen? Because sometimes when you're faced with a jury, okay, your mind, or you get distracted by you're looking at the jury and I wonder what they're thinking, I wonder what they're thinking. You're behind the screen. Do you feel as though you're more in control? Or are you more uncertain behind the screen?
Okay.
Playing in front of a screen or like behind a screen doesn't erase the fact that I am thinking about what the jury might be writing down or thinking about what I'm playing. So just the fact that I can't see their faces, like I know they're there and I can hear their papers and their pencils and whispers and everything. So I'm still very aware that they're there. But at the same time, I don't have to be worried about how I look when I'm playing, or like if someone won't like if I move a certain way or something. It's in a way more freeing, I think, to play behind a screen.
Whenever it's an audition situation, I prefer to play behind a screen, even if it's for school auditions and local like youth orchestras and stuff that I'm sure we've all had experience auditioning for. It's usually not behind a screen, and then when you start doing professional auditions, it's always behind a screen. So I just prefer doing that because I feel like it's a much better preparation for the professional world. And listening from behind a screen, I'm sure people hear different things. And from my point of view, like, sometimes it's a bit weird when the screen is right in front of you because they'll have the screen in different places and different for different auditions. When it's right in front of you, sometimes it feels like I'm just playing into a wall, but at the same time, it's like, this is my space to focus on what I need to do right now. And I'm not worried about what anyone is thinking because I've prepared and this is how I play. So that's why I like playing behind the screen.
I agree with what was said. On the contrary, sometimes, when you have the screen, it's hard to get in a like, performance mentality? Like when you come out and you see people there, then something like can click in your mind that's like, okay, this is a performance, this is not an option. So I think the thing is with the screen, like you just have to get used to just imagining that the, like the audience behind you and thinking of it more as a performance rather than an audition.
Yeah, for me it's harder when there's a screen because I don't really feel like I'm present. Like, I feel like there's something there, and then it's harder like to be the other side of the screen.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Well, it's been a long evening. Thank you very much. Thanks to the five of you.